Good morning, everyone, and welcome in the name of the Lord Jesus to Ahorey Presbyterian Church today, and it is so good to see you, to welcome those especially who are visiting, and to greet, as ever, those watching the live stream and also in time listening on CD. I always begin in this way, and begin in this way very deliberately. We have a mission, and that mission is to magnify Christ by making disciples in Ahorey and beyond. And in this regard, as ever, written announcements have been prepared. There are printed copies available, and they've been distributed, or they will be distributed, I should say, via WhatsApp as well. I want to commend to you just a number of those announcements. First of all, we meet this evening at 6:30 here in Ahorey as we continue our series on the attributes of God. And it would be really good to see you this evening as we take this opportunity, this God-given opportunity, to meet in this way on the Lord's Day. On Wednesday evening, then, we will have our midweek meeting at 8 o'clock in Clare, and this will be to continue our series on the Sermon on the Mount. So please do come to Clare on Wednesday evening at 8 o'clock. On Friday evening, then, we have our Good Friday service, which will begin at 8 o'clock in the evening. That's Good Friday, 8 o'clock in the evening. And as has been our custom very recently, it will be a communion service. So this is open to all who know and love the Lord Jesus Christ, and it is a golden opportunity, especially given it's being Good Friday, to gather around his table. That's Friday evening at 8 o'clock. And then next Sunday, we look forward to our Easter Sunday morning service as we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that, as ever, will be at 10:30. I do commend to you all of the announcements, and all are subject, as ever, to the will of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, let us now set the tone for this week of worship that lies before us. Let us, in this gathering, worship the triune God at his gracious call and invitation as we hear his word in Luke chapter 9 and verse 51. A few short words, but so poignant with meaning. When the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. The Lord Jesus knew that in Jerusalem, he would meet his death on a cross. But for the glory of his Father and for the salvation of his people, he made the journey and did so resolutely. For you and for me, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. Let's respond to God's word as we stand to sing our opening praise. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and pour contempt on all my pride. Well, let us now approach our Father, our great Father, in adoration and confession as we pray. Father, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign as the one living and true God, and there is none like you. You alone are glorious in holiness. You alone are infinitely, eternally, and unchangeably beautiful. How tragic it is then, Father, that our hearts beat so quickly for lesser things. Our desires, our affections, and therefore our lives are in disarray and disorder. Father, have mercy upon us, we pray. And as we look to this wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, we ask you, pardon our iniquity. Pardon our iniquity, and by your Spirit, draw us to lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and to run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of your glorious throne. In his name and by his Spirit, we pray. And together we say, Amen. Well, let all who repent and believe the gospel hear the assurance of pardon from the lips of God himself. Galatians chapter 2, verses 19 and 20 say, "For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." To all who repent and believe the gospel, I, as a believing sinner, as a fellow believing sinner, promise on the authority of God's word and in the name of the only Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of all your sins, and declare you to be loosed of your sins on earth, and that you are loosed of them in heaven also forever. To which we say hallelujah and amen. Well, our Old Testament reading on this Palm Sunday is Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 to 13, which you will find on page 797 of the Church Bibles. So please turn to Zechariah chapter 9 in the Old Testament, and beginning at verse 9, let us listen to the word of God. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. For I have bent Judah as my bow. I have made Ephraim its arrow. I will stir up your sons, O Zion, against your sons, O Greece, and wield you like a warrior's sword. Amen. And so reads the word of God. Well, we now receive instruction from the Heidelberg Catechism concerning this very Messiah about whom Zechariah prophesied. As ever, I'll ask the questions, and I invite you to answer with me. And I would have to say that even giving the richness and the beauty of this catechism, these two questions and answers stand out somehow as especially rich and beautiful. Question 31. Why is he called Christ or Messiah, meaning anointed? Answer. Because he has been ordained by God the Father and has been anointed with the Holy Spirit to be our chief prophet and teacher, who fully reveals to us the secret counsel and will of God concerning our deliverance, our only high priest, who has delivered us by the one sacrifice of his body, and who continually intercedes for us before the Father, and our eternal King, who governs us by his word and spirit, and who guards us and keeps us in the deliverance he has won for us. Prophet, priest, and king. These are the offices of the one who is called the Christ. But that still leaves the question, 32, but why are you called a Christian? And all who repent and believe the gospel may answer, because by faith I am a member of Christ, and so I share in his anointing. I am anointed to confess his name, to present myself to him as a living sacrifice of thanks, to strive with a free conscience against sin and the devil in this life, and afterward to reign with Christ over all creation for eternity. How's that for richness? How's that for beauty? I ask the question, could there be anything more wonderful? Even in all our sufferings, could there be anything more wonderful in all the universe than to be a Christian? Let's respond as we stand to sing how sweet the name of Jesus sounds in a believer's ear. And as we sing, a collection for his work will be taken up.
Sounds in a believer.
Well, boys and girls, please come down to the front just now, and I'll see you in a wee moment or two. Well, everyone, it is so great to see you today. You're off on holidays now, aren't you? Which is great. Absolutely. Do you know what? There are so many great things about Easter. Just while I'm turning to my page, can you think of any? What's the first thing that comes into your head when you think of Easter? Yeah. Easter eggs, of course, Kathy. I think pretty much everyone in the entire building is thinking along those lines. Yes, babe? The Easter Bunny comes. Wow. Okay. Hopefully with Easter eggs in tow. No, very good. Very good. Let me share with you the story that is at the very heart of Easter. And I'm going to do so with the help of this book. So it's called God's Big Promises Bible Storybook. It's written by Carl Leiferton. It's actually illustrated by a lady from Ballymena. Full places called Jennifer Davison, so Northern Ireland's represented. So God's Big Promises Bible Storybook, and I'm going to read to you the story of Easter. So let's listen and see as we think about what is at the heart of this Easter time. Hundreds of years before Jesus was born, God's messenger Zechariah had said that when God's promised-keeping king came, he would ride into Jerusalem on a young donkey. Jesus and his friends were near Jerusalem, so he sent two of his disciples to a village. "You will find a young donkey there," he told them. "Untie it and bring it to me." The disciples found the donkey just as Jesus had said they would, and Jesus rode it into Jerusalem. Crowds of people spread their cloaks and tree branches across the road in front of him. "Yay! This is the king from great King David's family. This is the king God promised to send," they shouted. "This is the king who will bring happiness because he has come from God." Some of the religious leaders were not happy, though. "Tell these people to stop saying these things about you," they grumbled to Jesus. Well, Jesus said, "If these people have to keep quiet, I will get the stones on this road to shout about who I am." And off he rode on his donkey into Jerusalem. Jesus went to the temple. He was very, very unhappy about what he saw there, because people were using it as a shop where they could make money instead of as a place where they could pray to God. So Jesus tipped over the tables of the people who were selling things. "God has said that this should be a place for people from all over the world to pray in," he said, "but you're using it to steal from others." Well, the religious leaders were angry. They wanted to get rid of Jesus. Then they heard some children shouting, "Jesus is the king from great King David's family. Yay!" Now they were even more angry. "Do you hear those children, Jesus?" they complained. "They are saying that you are God's promise-keeping king." "Yes, they are," answered Jesus. "God loves to hear big truths coming out of little mouths." Remember that. It was one of the most special days of the year, the day to remember how long ago God had rescued the Israelites from Egypt and made an unbreakable promise to love them as his people. Jesus and his friends shared the special remembering meal. Jesus knew that soon he would die on a cross. He wanted his friends to understand why he would let that happen.
So he took some bread and broke it into pieces. Whenever you eat bread together, I would like you to remember that my body was broken to rescue you, Jesus said. Then he took a cup of wine. Whenever you drink wine together, remember that I bled on the cross so that you can be forgiven. I am making a new, unbreakable promise to you. You will always be God's forgiven people. It's time for me to keep all the promises God has made, Jesus told his disciples. It's time for me to take the punishment you deserve for not loving and obeying God. I am the way to God's place. I tell the truth about God's place. I give people life in God's place. Jesus and his friends went to a garden to pray. It was very late, and everyone was really tired. Well, Jesus was feeling very, very sad. He knew that soon it would be time for him to die. And he knew that that would be very, very hard. So he spoke to his father. Dear Father, you can do anything. I would like you to take away the awful things that are going to happen to me, but most of all, I would like to do what you want me to do. The disciples were so tired that instead of helping Jesus, they fell asleep while he prayed. But God sent an angel to help Jesus and give him strength. Jesus woke his friends up. It's time, he told them. God's promises are coming true now. Jesus was standing in the garden with his friends. The religious leaders came with soldiers to take him away. Tell us the truth, the leaders demanded. Are you really God's chosen king? Are you really the Son of God? Yes, answered Jesus. And one day you will see me sitting on a throne and ruling over everything forever. We don't believe you, said the religious leaders. It's time to get rid of you. They took Jesus outside the city and put him on a cross. You don't look like a rescuing king now, they shouted. A thief was put on a cross next to Jesus. He said, Jesus, I know I deserve to be punished for what I've done wrong. Jesus, I know that you don't deserve to be punished because you've never done anything wrong. Jesus, I know that you're the king. Please, could I have a place in your kingdom in the life after this one? Jesus answered him, I promise you today, after we have both died, you will be with me in my wonderful place. Then Jesus died. The soldier who was watching said, this man really was the Son of God. Boys and girls, I said that that was the Easter story. That's not totally accurate because that's not where the story ends. And next Sunday, I'm going to read to you the rest of the story because that really isn't how it ends. I'm tempted to go further and tell you how it does end, and I think that you know. But let's wait until next Sunday. Before then, let's thank God for the cross on which Jesus died as our Savior King to take away our sins and to win for us a place in heaven. He is God's promise-keeping King who loved us so much that he died for us that we might live. And on that note, let's stand together before you leave for Sunday school and let's sing When I Think About the Cross.
Yeah.
Well, let us now turn to the New Testament and to Paul's letter to the Romans. And as we continue to think about the cross, we read together Romans chapter 3, verses 21 to 26, on page 941 of the Church Bibles. Page 941, Romans chapter 3, and beginning to read at verse 21, let us listen to the Word of God. But now, the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Amen. So reads the word of God. Please keep your Bible open, and before listening to the preaching of the Bible, let us pray together. Father, by faith we stand at the foot of the cross. May we see by faith the King of the universe bleeding his heart out for us. As we listen to your word, may the Holy Spirit cause our hearts to be moved to trembling love and filled with trembling thankfulness. Do not permit this to be nothing to us. Rather, cause it to be everything to us. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. I like to commit crimes. God likes to forgive them. Really, the world is admirably arranged. The words of the 20th century poet, Whiston Hugh Auden. But is this how the world is arranged? Or take the words of the 18th century Empress Catherine of Russia. I shall be an autocrat. That is my trade. And the good Lord will forgive me. That is his. But is forgiveness really God's trade? Is that his job? Is that somehow what he's contracted and expected to do? Both of those quotations shine the light on the fact that many people, indeed you could say all people by nature, view God as some kind of very lenient Santa Claus. It's God's job to forgive. It's what he does. The reality, however, is very different. Romans chapter 1, verse 18
to which I invite you to look, swings like a wrecking ball through the lie. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. The holy God, to whom sin is grossly offensive, is rightly furious with sinful people. The holy God, to whom sin is grossly offensive, is rightly furious with sinful people. He is righteous. He acts consistently with his own holy character. So it is right for him to be furious. Indeed, it would be wrong for him not to be furious. If he were to overlook sin, he would deny himself and the cosmos would implode. No, his justice must be satisfied in the punishment of sinful people. Can you see the problem? Can you feel the problem? If the merciful God is to rescue sinful people from his right anger, he must do so rightly. But we deserve punishment. And we must be punished. So how can we be spared? This is our problem. The single greatest problem that any of us has. Can you see it? Can you feel it? It is at this point that the cross comes gloriously into view, because it was on that cross that God unveiled, to the astonishment of angels and demons, his astonishing solution. In Christ, God lovingly absorbed his own wrath. In Christ, God mercifully received his own judgment. So he is right to rescue believing sinners, because he has punished them in Christ at the cross. And this is the gospel of God. This is the good news of God. This is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. In Christ, God lovingly absorbed his own wrath against the sinners he loved. I have 3 points today as we unfurl Paul's teaching in the verses that we read. Here is the first, from verse 21 through to the first part of verse 24. A righteous status is given to believers. A righteous status is given to believers. But now, Paul says in verse 21, in one respect, there are no more wonderful words in the whole Bible than these two words. But now. But now. The righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law.
although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. Look at the two clarifying points that Paul makes here. One is negative, the other is positive. Negatively, note that the law never provided a way to get right with God. That was never its purpose. Paul's words in verse 20 were clear. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified, declared righteous in his sight. Since through the law comes knowledge of sin. That's the negative clarification. Positively, however, the Old Testament writings, the law and the prophets, testified to God's way of salvation. His gift of righteousness in Christ has always been the only way of rescue. The Old Testament has been helpfully likened to a fully furnished, though darkened, room. All the furniture is there. When you read the Old Testament, all the furniture of the gospel, as it were, is there. You just cannot see it clearly. In the same way, the saving righteousness of God, partly concealed in the Old Testament, has now been fully revealed in the New. And this righteousness of God, this saving righteousness of God, Paul goes on to say in verse 22, is through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. And the reason why only believers in Jesus receive this righteousness is found in the final part of verse 22 through to the end of verse 23. These verses are a summary of Paul's teaching in chapter 1, verse 18, the whole way through to chapter 3, verse 20. For there is no distinction. For all have sinned. Jews, Gentiles, all have sinned and fall short of or lack the glory of God, having exchanged the glory of the Creator for the shadow glory of created things. That is, having turned from the worship of the true God to that of idols, we have lost our glory as godlike creatures made in His own image. Friends, by nature, we are sinners. All have sinned and lack the glory of God. So the only way that we can get right with Him is by believing in Jesus, by receiving through faith the gift of His righteousness. We cannot save ourselves. Full stop. It is impossible. Only the Lord can rescue. See how clearly Paul says this at the beginning of verse 24. Believers are justified, declared right in His sight by His grace as a gift. Christ's righteousness is counted as their own, and they are accepted by God. Once they stood condemned, guilty as charged, but now they have been declared righteous, justified by His grace as a gift. Our righteous status is given to believers. That's our first point. Here's the second, from the second part of verse 24 through to the first part of verse 25. A righteous status is given to believers in a righteous way. A righteous status is given to believers in a righteous way. Listen to Paul in verse 24. Believers are justified by his grace as a gift. How? Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. Now, the word redemption brings into focus the truth that we all are born in slavery, slaves to sin. We all are born enslaved to sin. And it brings into focus also the truth that Christ died on the cross to set us free. In Christ, God has set us free from our sinful and deadly slavery. And our acceptance with God is founded upon this great achievement of our Redeemer. How am I declared right with God? The answer is I'm led back to the cross, to the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. And there I see the answer. But Paul delves even deeper. He doesn't stop there. He delves even deeper to the very heart, the very beating heart of Christ's sacrifice, to the awesome truth to which I introduced you at the outset. By nature, we are under the wrath of God. God is rightly angry with us. It is right for him to be very angry. It would be wrong for him not to be very angry, and there is nothing that we can do about that. But, Paul says in verse 25, God put Christ forward as a propitiation, as a wrath-absorbing, wrath-quenching sacrifice by his blood to be received by faith. Again, in Christ, God lovingly absorbed his own wrath against the sinners he loved. Listen to how two preachers have expressed this. Both lived during the 20th century. They expressed the truth in different words, but the substance is the same. Charles Cranfield, a commentator, wrote these words. God, because in his mercy he willed to forgive sinful men, and being truly merciful, willed to forgive them righteously, that is, without in any way condoning their sin. And then listen to this. Purposed to direct against his own very self, in the person of his Son, the full weight of that righteous wrath that they deserved. It is amazing. John Stott marveled at it like this, moved by the perfection of his own holy love. God in Christ substituted himself for us sinners. Believers, our Lord Jesus took our place, assumed our identity, died our death. We have been punished in him. And so when God justifies us, when God declares us right in his sight, he does the right thing. This righteous status is given to us in a righteous way. He rightly rescues all who believe in Jesus. This is our second point. A righteous status is given to believers in a righteous way. Here's the third and final point. From the second part of verse 25 through to the end of verse 26, a righteous status is given to believers in a righteous way by the righteous God. The righteous God. At the cross, we see God saving sinners, and we see God revealing himself. The cross, as Stott rightly said, was a word as well as a work. It comes to me now, I think it was John Calvin who spoke of the cross as the pulpit of God's love. What does the cross tell us about him? Well, Paul says that God put Christ forward as a propitiation to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. The cross shows us that God is and always has been right, just to justify, right to rescue, fair to forgive. When he passed over sins in the Old Testament, he wasn't brushing them under the carpet. He justly justified, he rightly rescued, he fairly forgave Abraham, Moses, and David. How? Based on the future sacrifice of Christ. The cross shows us that the God who rescues is righteous. He saves sinners in such a way that his integrity is upheld and that all his glorious attributes, all his glorious characteristics are magnified. At the cross, his holy love was satisfied. Justice and mercy kissed each other. Righteousness and truth, they met together. He is just and astonishingly the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. He is our righteous rescuer. And no other so-called God comes close in comparing with him. Conclude by sharing with you a poem entitled The Harmony of the Divine Perfections, written in the 18th century by Samuel Stennett. It betrays the angels in heaven marveling at the cross. And let's be clear today, the angels in heaven are marveling at the cross. The demons in hell right now are trembling at the cross. What about you? When first the God of boundless grace disclosed his kind design to rescue our apostate race from misery, shame, and sin, quick through the realms of light and bliss, the joyful tidings ran. Each heart exulted at the news that God would dwell with man. Yet, midst their joys, they paused a while and asked with strong surprise, "But how can injured justice smile or look with pitying eyes? Will the Almighty deign again to visit yonder world and hither bring rebellious men whence rebels once were hurled? Their tears and groans and deep distress aloud for mercy call, but must truth and righteousness to mercy victims fall?" So spoke the friends of God and man, delighted yet surprised, eager to know the wondrous plan that wisdom had devised. The Son of God, attentive heart, and quickly thus replied, "In me let mercy be revered, and justice satisfied. Behold, my vital blood I pour, a sacrifice to God. Let angry justice now no more demand the sinner's blood. He spoke, and heaven's high arches rung with shouts of loud applause. He died, the friendly angels sung, nor cease their rapturous joys. This is the wonder. This is the wonder of the cross. The wonder that causes angels to marvel. The wonder that causes demons to tremble. The wonder, surely, that causes all who confess their sin and believe the gospel to bow in worship. To bow low in worship today and forever. A righteous status is given to believers in a righteous way by the righteous God. And this, praise his holy name, is the wonder of the cross. Shall we pray? Father, thank you that through the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, you righteously rescue sinners. You justly justify and fairly forgive us. There your attributes are together magnified, and there your name is forever glorified. Here indeed, Father, is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. Father, in this Palm Sunday, may we be humble together under this grace and united in mission to your glory, even as we now pray for the church and for the world. Father, we pray with thanksgiving for King Charles III and for all who are in high positions in society, that such wisdom be given them, that we may lead peaceful and quiet lives, godly and dignified in every way, which is good and pleasing in your sight, O God, our Saviour. Father, we pray today for all who are suffering, including the King and the Princess of Wales, and all in Eastern Europe and the Middle East, that you would draw all who are suffering to embrace and to go on embracing your Son, that in him they might find a hope that lifts their weary heads, that soothes their troubled hearts, and will prove to stand the test of time. Father, we ask you by your Spirit to grant such wisdom to those charged with administering your tithes and offerings in this place, that the gospel may be commended in Ahorey and beyond, including in Italy and in Moldova. And we do thank you today for Antonio and Anna, and for Mihai and Irina, and for all the believers in Peskici, Vico, and Chisinau. And upon them we pray your blessing. Father, as we scatter and gather this week, may the making of disciples through the prayerful speaking of your word be our priority. May we and all churches throughout the world, including those suffering persecution, bow in worship before the wondrous cross of your Son, through whom you righteously rescue sinners. In his name and by his Spirit we pray, and together we say, Amen. This, the power of the cross, Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross. Let us further respond to God's word
as we stand to sing our closing hymn.
The Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all today until the return of the King, in whose wounds your name is written, and then forevermore. Amen.